Jai Radha Madhava Jai Kunja Bihari. Jai Gopi Jana Vallabha, Jai Giri Varadhari, Jai Giri Varadhari. Jai Gopi Jana Vallabha, Jai Giri Varadhari, Jai Giri Varadhari. Jaya Yasoda Nandana, Jaya Braja Jana Ranjana, Jaya Braja Jana Ranjana. Jaya Yasoda Nandana, Jai Braja Jana Ranjana, Jai Braja Jana Ranjana. Yamuna Tirabana Chare Jai Kunja Bihari. Jaya Yamuna Tirabana Chare Jai Kunja Bihari. Jai Radha Madhava Jaya Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Jaya Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Jaya Kunja Bihari. Jaya Jai Om Vishnu Pada Paramahamsa Parivrajakacharya Ashtodharaksa Srimad is Divine Grace Srila Bhai Charanaravinda Bhakti Vedanta Goswami Maharaj Srila Prabhupada Ki ISKCON Bibli Sansthapaka Acharya Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai Om Vishnu Pada Paramahamsa Parivrajakacharya Ashtodharaksa Srimad is Divine Grace Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur Prabhupada Ki Ananta Koti Vaishnav Vrinda Ki Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur Ki Prem Se Kaho Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Ki Shri Shri Radha Krishna Gop Gopinath Shyamakunda Radha Kunda Sri Giri Govardhan Ki Brajbhumi Sri Vrindavan Dham Ki Purushottam Kshetra Sri Jagannath Puri Dham Ki Navadvip Mayapur Dham Ki Ganga Mai Jamuna Mai Ki Bhakti Devi Tulasi Maharani Ki Kaliyuga Pavan Hari Nama Sankirtan Ki Hare Krishna Mahamantra Ki Srila Prabhupada Transcendental Book Distribution Ki Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavat Mahapurana Ki Nitai Gaura Premanande All glories to assembled devotees, all glories to assembled devotees, all glories to assembled devotees, all glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Agyanati Mirandhasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshur Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swamin Itinamine Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharane Nirivishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Desha Tarine Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 21, Text Number 12 and 13, Explanation of the Vedic Path. Dhanya, Daru, Asthi, Tantunam, Rasa, Taijasa, Sharmanam, Kala, Vayu, Agni, Mrit, Toyai, Parthivanam, Yutayutai, Dhanya Daru Asti Tantunam Rasa Taijasa Charmanam Kalavayu Agni Mrit Toyai Parthivanam Yatayutaihi Dhanya Daru Asti Tantunam Rasa Taijasa Charmanam Kalavayu Agni Mrittoyai Parthivanam Yutayutaihi Dhanya Daru Asti Tantunam Rasa Taijasa Charmanam Kalavayu Agni Mrit Toyai पार्थिवानां युतायुतैः Matajis. Dhanya of grains, daru of wood in the form of both ordinary objects and sacred utensils, asthi bone such as elephant tusks, tantunam and thread, rasa of liquids, oil, ghee, etc., taijasa, fiery objects, gold, etc., charmanam and skins, kala by time, vayu by air, agni by fire, mrit by earth, tojai and by water, parthivana also of earthen objects such as chariot wheels, mud, pots, bricks, etc., juta in combination, a yutai or separately. Various objects such as grains, wooden utensils, things made of bone, thread, liquids, objects derived from fire, skins and earthy objects are all purified by time, by the wind, by fire, by earth and by water, either separately or in combination. Purport. The word kala or time is mentioned here since all purificatory processes take place within time. Text 13. Amidhyaliptam yat yena gandhalepam vyapohati bhajate prakritim tasya tatshaucham tavat ishyate. Translation and purport by disciples of His Divine Grace, Shilayasi Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. A particular purifying agent is considered appropriate when its application removes the bad odor or dirty covering of some contaminated object and makes it resume its original nature. Furniture, kitchen utensils, clothing and other objects are purified by application of abrasion, alkali, acid, water and so on. One thereby removes the bad fragrance or impure coating of such objects, restoring them to their original clean appearance. So, this particular section of the 11th canto, especially these few verses, ending with the 14th verse, which will be taken on Tuesday, is basically describing the processes of purification. So, the whole idea of the Vedic principles is how we can become purified of our contaminated tendencies for controllership and enjoyership. Kalena snana shauchabhyam samskare tapase jaya shudhyanti dane santushtya atmatma vritya. So in the 10th canto of Bhagavatam it is described that there are various ways of purifying various things. Kalena, through time, one purifies objects in material nature like mountains, leaves, trees. Snana, the body is purified by bathing. Shauchabhyam, objects like utensils and clothes are purified by applying purifying material. Sanskarai, birth is purified by sanskar. Tapasa, senses are purified by austerity, by restricting the use of the senses with the sense objects. Ijjaya, objects are purified by offering in worship. A flower is ordinary, but when the flower is offered in worship to the Lord, people take that flower and place it on their head, because it has become worshipable. And shudhyanti dhanai, similarly, money is purified by giving in charity, dana. Santushtya, the mind is purified by a feeling of santosh or satisfaction, because the mind will keep demanding more and more. But when we are able to draw the boundaries to the mind and the desires, that this is the limit and I will remain satisfied within this, this is the way the mind can be purified of its tendencies for hankering and lamentation. And therefore, Atma, the soul, is purified by Atma Vidyaya, by knowledge of self-realization and practice of the process of self-realization. So, in the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, Vishwanachakra Thakur, he explains, while giving commentaries to the 10th canto, Mat gavir api gopala svikuryat kripaya yadi tadaivasam payah pitva heyayustad priyajanah. So he says that Mat gavir api gopala svikuryat kripaya yadi. My dear Lord Gopal, if you accept whatever I am writing, if this is considered to be like the words, my mind is to be like cow, Mat gavir api gopala svikuryat kripaya yadi, please accept my offering, my consciousness, just like a cow. Tadai vasam payah pitva, and through this, the meanings which I want to churn out from the Srimad Bhagavatam will be like the milk. And may these meanings of the Srimad Bhagavatam give great joy and pleasure, tat priya janaha, to the devotees. So therefore, you become the cowherd boy, and my intelligence and my effort and my consciousness becomes like the cow. And from that, O Gopala, you try to draw out the milk of the appropriate meanings of the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. So therefore, in the 10th canto, 90th chapter, towards the end of the Srimad Bhagavatam, 10th canto, text number 47 describes the super excellence of Krishna's appearance and the way Krishna appeared to purify this material world has not been seen by any other incarnation. As it is described in the Srimad Bhagavatam 8th canto by Gajendra ji, na vidyate yasya na janma karma va na naam roopo gunadosha eva va tathapi lokapi asambhavaya swa mayaya tan anukalam richati. As far as cleansing is concerned, the most important cleansing element in the entire creation is Krishna. And therefore Krishna appears and performs pastimes in order to deliver the devotees and to annihilate the demons and purify all inauspiciousness and creates auspiciousness. And therefore Krishna does not have any material name, form, pastimes, etc. All of his pastimes are completely pure. And therefore Gajendra ji says that the Lord, he appears in this material world through his internal potency to perform these pastimes and attract our contaminated minds towards those pastimes so that we can become purified. And therefore, these pastimes perform the task of purifying our impure consciousness and tendencies. So in this one particular verse of the 47th shloka of the 90th chapter, this particular verse describes five unique qualities of Krishna which distinguish him from all the other incarnations. So on the occasion of the upcoming Janmashtami festival, we will discuss this theme about how Krishna purifies the creation and especially the earthly planet by performing his pastimes, and what are the five unique qualities or special glories of Krishna which even his expansions and others do not have. Krishnera jateka khela sarvottama naralila naravapu jahara swarupa. Amongst Krishna's appearances and pastimes in different avatars, when Krishna appears as Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, that is considered to be very unique. Sarvottama narilla, it is considered to be the best. So what are these five elements? The first is described here, that Tirtham chakre nripa unam yat ajani yadushu swasarit padasaukam padashaucham. So this is the first line of the verse which describes that Krishna's fame or reputation eclipsed even that of Mother Ganges. So amongst different incarnations, when Krishna appears as Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he is the most famous. His yasha is unparalleled. And therefore, it is described that various misconceptions abound in this world. What are some of these misconceptions? First, the misconception is that money can purchase happiness. Second misconception is technology can create prosperity. Third misconception is weapons can create security. And fourth misconception is the earth has unlimited capacity to provide resources and unlimited capacity to absorb the wastes. And in this way, these are the five main misconceptions. And you can read Devamrit Maharaj's latest book on unnatural happiness. And these five concepts are described in graphic detail very beautifully. So therefore, the question is asked, where can you find uninterrupted pleasure in this material world? If you feel that through sense gratification I can get uninterrupted pleasure, the question is, where is uninterrupted pleasure available? First is in spiritual world, Goloka Vrindavan. Second is in your imagination. Otherwise, within the material world, the pleasure can never be uninterrupted. And therefore, here it is described that Ganga Shataguna Prayo Mathure Mama Mandale Jamuna Vishruta Devi Natra Karya Vicharana. So Chakravarti Pad is giving this quotation that previously Ganga was considered superior to all the holy places. But with the appearance of Krishna, Yamuna Bishruta Devi Natra Karya Vicharana, his glories became the supreme purifying Tirtha. The glories of Krishna became the supreme purifying place of pilgrimage and holy place. So therefore, in the Srimad Bhagavatam first canto, it is described, Yat Pada Samshreya Suta Munaya Prashamanaya Sadhyo Punanti Upasrishta Swardhuni Apunu Sevaya. That yes, Ganges does purify, but hearing the glories of Krishna sitting at the lotus feet of devotees has a very powerful purifying effect. So Narad Muni describes in Narada Bhakti Sutra what is a good day and what is a bad day. He says that Taddinam Durdinam Manye Megachadam Na Durdinam. That he says, you may think when the sky is overcast with cloud and it is raining heavily, that is a bad day. So today it is raining very heavily, and you may not be able to fulfill all your plans. So you may think, today is a bad day. So he's saying, Taddinam durdinam manye mega achhadam na durdinam. The day when the sky is covered with clouds and it is raining heavily, that is not a bad day. Yad dinam Krishna samlapa katha piyusha varjitam. That day when you do not get an opportunity to hear Krishna katha, that is a bad day. So when rains fall, that is not a problem. But when the nectar of Harikatha does not fall, that is a bad day. And therefore here, he says that Kova Bhagavatastasya Punya Shlokedya Karmana Shuddhi Kamo Anushrunayat Yashah Kalimalapah. The glories of Krishna can thus purify the contamination of this age of Kali. And therefore, this is described very beautifully. And so, here it is described that Nivritta Tarashair Upagiyamana Bhavaushadat Shrotra Manobhiramat Ka Uttama Shloka Gunanuvadat Puman Birajet Bina. That the nature of Harikatha is such, it is attractive to devotees, it is attractive to the sadhakas, it is also attractive to the materialists. Because the materialists consider that you cannot get this kind of exciting flavor of politics, romance, sports, adventure, conspiracy, apart from that in Krishna Lila. And therefore so many people come and try to make movies out of it, serials out of it. Krishna stole butter 5,000 years ago. But just singing about that, so many people are becoming millionaires simply by singing about the glories of Krishna, because Krishna's glories are eternally famous. We were in a yatra in Vrindavan, and Deen Bandhu Prabhu was taking us for the parikrama, and we entered the Yamuna river, and then he suddenly asked, which is more powerful and what is the difference between Ganga and Yamuna? Ganga snan and Yamuna snan. So we did not have any idea. So we said, you only tell. So he said, Ganga snan purifies you of all papa, and Yamuna snan purifies you of all papa and punya. When we heard this, some of us started coming out. That who wants to be purified of punya? But he says here that punya shlokedya karmana, beyond material punya and material papa, we have to accumulate spiritual punya. And therefore that is known as Shrinvatam Sukatam Krishna Punya Shravana Kirtana. That through Shravan and Kirtan, by transcendental sound vibration, we accumulate this transcendental punya. And that is the whole idea, that Krishna came to establish this punya by performing his pastimes. And so, prapanna janatananda sandoham pratitum prabhu. In the 10th canto, Brahmaji is making this statement that actually the Lord appears for what? Prapancham nishprapanchopi vidambayasi bhutale. Vidambayasi is performs pastimes. For what? Prapancham, for those who are trapped within this material world. Nishprapanchopi, to make them escape. He performs these pastimes. Prapanna janatananda, so that those who are surrendered can also experience the pleasure. So those who are trapped get the chance to liberate. Those who are liberated, they develop great joy and ecstasy. Sandoham. So sandoham is described as Krishna distributes various flavors of his pastimes. And therefore, in that purport, it is described just like ice cream comes in various flavors. Those flavors increase the joy. Like that, Krishna's pastimes are not stereotyped or only of one type. He simply comes to share those pastimes with others. And therefore, here it is described that he performs those pastimes to expand the ecstasies of his devotees. Athanyat api krishnasya toka charitam adbhutam manusham lokamasadhya tat jatim anurundhata. And so Krishna comes and performs specifically pastimes as a child, so that the human society takes notice of this. And amongst pastimes of Krishna, Krishna's pastimes in Bal Leela are considered to be the most attractive of all. And therefore here, this is what is the most important element, that Krishna, through his pastimes, attracts the attention of each and every person through his multifarious flavors. Nemam virincho na bhavo na shrir api anga samshraya prasade lebhire gopi yattat prapya vimuktidat nayam sukhapo bhagavan dehinam gopika suta jnaninam chatma bhutanam yata bhaktimatam iha. Krishna performs his pastimes to send a message to the conditioned souls. You are eager to be a controller in this material world. If you are eager to be a controller in this material world, I am giving you an offer. Become my controller. Try to control me. And so Krishna offers this and allows himself to be controlled by the love of Mother Yashoda. And that is what the entire Damodar Leela is all about, how Mother Yashoda is controlling Krishna through the power of her love. And therefore, Krishna's pastimes in this world are considered to be absolutely enchanting and attractive. Srimad Bhagavata Arthanam Aswadam Rasikai Saha Swajati Ashaye Snigdhe Sadhu Sangha Svatovare. But that nectar of the pastimes is released by a certain process. Just like juice is there within sugarcane, but that juice needs to be taken out by a certain process. Similarly, the nectar of multiple flavors are there within the pages of Srimad Bhagavatam, within the transcendental narrations of the pastimes of Srimad Bhagavatam. But how will that transcendental sound vibration create impact in our lives? Srimad Bhagavata Arthanam Aswadai, you have to taste it, Rasikai Saha, along with the devotees. Rather than speaking prajalpa, discussing all kinds of politics, what a devotee should actually do is spend quality time discussing from the pages of Srimad Bhagavatam. And this element is becoming more and more extinct in the association of devotees. As the society of devotees is growing, the number of resources are not lacking, but the will to apply oneself to the strict prescribed process, which is actually written in lines of stone by the acharyas, which cannot be changed by our speculation or by desire. To get the intended effect, we have to follow the process somehow or the other. And therefore, Srimad Bhagavata Arthanam Aswadai, one must relish this Rasikai Saha in the association of devotees. And what kind of devotees? Sajati Ashaye Snigdhe. With those devotees with whom we can actually exchange the loving sentiments of six loving exchanges. Sajati Ashaye Snigdhe Sadhu Sangha Svatovare, and those whom we consider to be superior to us and whom we consider to be worshipable. And in that mood, we try to hear from such devotees. So therefore, this is the whole idea that in the association of devotees, even if a little bit of Krishna Katha is heard, anything about Krishna is heard, it has an impact. There was one person in one of the towns near Mumbai, and he was working in an office and he was going through a lot of trouble in the office, and he felt that people are troubling him too much. There is too much of office politics. What should I do? He was thinking and contemplating. So he went to one of his friends, and his friend said, well, you know, if possible, you can try to, you know, buy some spiritual literature. Maybe it will help you. So as he was passing by, he came across a devotee selling Bhagavad Gita. So he stood there and was looking at the Gita, and he was asking, so what is this all about? And this devotee said, Krishna spoke the Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna when Arjuna could ultimately not deal with the politics of the Kauravas. So finally Krishna told him Bhagavad Gita and inspired him to fight, because ultimately that was the only way he could end all the politics. So when he heard the word politics, he said, oh, he said, this book is describing about politics? He said, of course, Mahabharata is all about the politics between the Kauravas and the Pandavas. This is the essence of all of that politics, the Bhagavad Gita. So he thought, this is very interesting. I should take this, because it has Krishna on the cover and Arjuna is standing there, and Krishna is speaking something to Arjuna. Arjuna has his weapons. So looks like Krishna is giving him some yantra, some tantra of how to deal with the politics. So by studying this, Maybe I'll be able to cope with my politics in the office and defeat all my enemies. So he took the Bhagavad Gita. And then till first chapter it appeared like some hope is there on political discussion. But from second chapter onwards, the philosophy was so heavy that it went beyond politics. And then he was thinking, well, maybe in the next chapter there is something. So he read the next chapter. It went deeper. So he thought, "Arey, there must be some understanding of how to deal with the politics." He went on going fourth chapter, fifth chapter. By the time he came to ninth chapter, he started chanting. And by the time he came to the 18th chapter, he became inspired to start a satsang program in his own hometown. And he became the leader there, and he got initiated. And then he said that Bhagavad Gita is the ultimate literature which takes you beyond all the internal conflicts and external conflicts and connects you with Krishna. And therefore, this whole idea of Krishna speaking the Bhagavad Gita is to connect our consciousness to the higher principle, rise above the conflicts of this world. And so here, it is described that when we come in the association of devotees, then we get access to these tattvas. Krishna tattva, bhakti tattva, prema tattva sar, bhava tattva, rasa tattva, lila tattva ar. All of these tattvas are churned through the wonderful discussion of Harikatha. And this has an effect of purifying more powerful than that of Ganges. And so when Srila Prabhupada was preaching, somebody came to him and started arguing with Srila Prabhupada. And he said, "Is God light?" Prabhupada said, "He is darkness also. Because when Krishna is there, along with Krishna, his energies, Maya is also there." Then someone asked, "You say that the sun and moon are like the eyes of the Lord. If the sun and moon are eyes of Krishna, we are able to see the sun and the moon. We are able to see the eyes of Krishna. Why we are not able to see the face?" Prabhupada said, in a dark room, when there is no light, when a cat is there, and you go inside, you will only see the eyes of the cat, not the face of the cat. Material world is a place of darkness, therefore you see only the eyes of Krishna, not the face. So Prabhupada expressed that to overcome this consciousness of tamogun in the material world, the only method is to connect with this Krishna Katha. And so it is described that there are four types of Krishna Katha. First is incidental, where we just read casually. Somehow or the other we come across and we start reading. Second is, it is purposeful. We approach the Krishna Katha in a purposeful manner and repeat it. Third is, we actually are practicing it and we are actually focused on it and recall it, like the six Goswamis who were recalling Krishna's pastimes. And then fourth is, there is specific remembrance of the pastimes. So incidental reading, purposeful repeating, and particular recall and specific remembrance, all of these are described as ways by which we can connect with Krishna Katha. And Chakravarti Pad gives his purport that activities of a person, even if not extraordinary, create an impression of wonder in the heart and mind of someone, not because of the activity itself, but because we have created a special affection and love for that person. And so he says that it may be ordinary activities, But those ordinary activities are seen as extraordinary based on the emotions of love and affection we have for that person. So therefore, when we hear the Harikatha, what makes that Harikatha filled with wonder is not just the Katha itself, but apart from that is the feeling of love and affection which the hearer and the reader has for those pastimes. And therefore, Prabhupada mentions, even very wonderful activities performed by a person, but who is not friend but inimical, does not create any impression. So therefore, what creates the impression and impact is the feelings of emotion which we have towards that particular person. And those feelings need to be generated. And therefore, we find that Srila Prabhupada has written all of these books, and these books were written in the middle of the night. All through the night, from 12 o'clock onwards till early morning, Prabhupada was writing these books. And why did he write these books? So that we can study it, get connected with Krishna's glories, and get transformed. And therefore, Srila Prabhupada did this for us. And when we develop that gratitude for Srila Prabhupada, then we would love to connect with these books and hear his Bhakti Vedanta purports, which will create transformation in our heart. And therefore, when Prabhupada's disciples were with Srila Prabhupada, what really created that impact was they had that feeling of gratitude and they were in awe with Srila Prabhupada's activities. And so, what creates impact is a combination of the activity and the emotion for that person. So Prabhupada was talking to one reporter, and as he is sitting and talking, the reporter is asking questions and Prabhupada is answering. And the reporter becomes very much impressed and inspired that here is an old person who has come to America and created such a transformation. And as Prabhupada is speaking, Prabhupada takes a piece of orange in his hand, one orange, and he starts putting one peel of, one by one, you know, one of the pieces of orange in his mouth. And as he's chewing upon the orange, now and then he's speaking also, speaking from the Bhagavad Gita, giving an explanation to the reporter. And then as he's speaking and the orange seed is coming in his mouth, Prabhupada turns around. And then there is one waste bin and Prabhupada spits, and that seed goes through the air, through the trajectory, and finds its place exactly in that bin. And then Prabhupada gets the next seed in his mouth, throws that seed, that also goes into the bin. And the reporter is impressed that this person is able to find its mark every time. Every time that seed is finding its mark. And that reporter stops hearing what Prabhupada is saying. He is simply seeing how the seed is going there. And just by that very simple incident, he is so much in awe with Srila Prabhupada's personality that he joins ISKCON. Now hearing this, if you go to your preaching program with one dozen orange, nothing is going to happen, because it is the ultimate spiritual potency which is carried by the person because of constantly remembering and thinking about Krishna, which makes the impact, and that creates emotions in the hearts of those who are connected. And therefore here, this is the first principle, that Krishna's reputation eclipsed that of the Ganges. Tirtham chakre nripa unam yad apani yadushu swasarit pada shaucham. Second, apart from Krishna's yasha, the second principle in which Krishna excelled was Krishna's kripa. So what was extraordinary about Krishna's kripa is vidvit snigdhaha swarupam yayur ajita parashri yadarthe anya yatnah. Vidvit snigdhaha swarupam yayur ajita para. So Krishna, when he performed his pastimes as Krishna, he not only gave mercy to his devotees, but vidvit snigdhaha swarupam yayuhu. Through his unlimited compassion, he liberated even those who were his enemies and gave him several positions and opportunities to serve him. And therefore, for devotees, he gave personal association, and for the demons, he gave sayujya mukti. So what is taste is defined by Chakravarti Pad. He says, nectarian relish produced by the sound vibration that praises Krishna's glories, non-different from the sweet relish directly experienced when Krishna is personally present. And therefore, Krishna comes and not only delivers his devotees, but also delivers the demons. And so in the Srimad Bhagavatam, it is described, yascha mudatamo loke yascha buddhe paramgata tau ubhau sukham edete klishyanti antarito jana. That there are two kinds of people in this world. Yascha mudhatamo loke yascha buddhe paramgata. First, those who are paramahamsas, who are experiencing eternal bliss and joy. Second, those who are indulging in full-fledged sense gratification. Yascha mudhatamo loke. They have absolutely no idea about spiritual life. Just like Shri Radha Gopinath ji ki example is given. Suppose in a college, there are two categories of students who are without any anxiety before the exam. Right? First is who has studied very well, who has done several revisions. He is like the topper. One day before the exam, he is going to different people's rooms, sharing his experiences with them, creating anxiety to them also, that, oh, he studied so much. Right? He is the one whose notes are copied the most. So he is the absolute topper. He is in full bliss. He is looking forward for the exam, when the exam will come. Who is the second category? The second category is one who has never seen the professor's face. And he is fully convinced, even Krishna cannot save me. Even the Lord cannot do anything to me. And so one day before exam also he doesn't try. He said, full semester I have not tried, what I am going to try one day before. Let me go and see one movie and come back. So both are free from anxiety. Yascha mudhatamo loke yascha buddhe paramgata tau ubhau sukham edete. These are the only two categories which are in bliss. Who is in anxiety? Klishyanti antarito jana. Those who are in between experience anxiety. Who are they? Those who have studied a little bit, gone to the classes, have hopes and aspiration to pass, but their preparation is not up to the mark. Similarly, those who are started practicing the process, those who have not reached pure devotional service, but have already heard sense gratification is the source of misery, one has to follow the regulative principles. As soon as you have heard even one Srimad Bhagavatam class, you are in this middle category. Because Chakravarti Pad says, Ajamil got delivered because Ajamil's chanting was offenseless. By hearing this, many devotees get shocked. that I am following four regulative principles, not eating onion and garlic, and my chanting is offensive. Ajamil was doing all kinds of sinful activities, his chanting is offenseless. Why? Because as soon as you have understood what is to be done, what is not to be done, then the principle of offense begins. And therefore, here it is described that Krishna gives liberation to both the surrendered devotees and the enemies. So those who are in the middle, they have aspiration to pass. They want to pass. They are in anxiety about passing. Those who are not bothered about passing the exam don't even enter the exam hall. Or they may come, write something and go. But those who are in anxiety, they do their best to somehow pass. And that anxiety is very positive. I remember many years ago when we started the Bhakti Shastri exam here. So it was the first batch of Bhakti Shastri exam for our devotees. And so I gave the paper to everybody and I went out of the class because I thought this is Bhakti Shastri. So I can have full faith because these are devotees who are going to be writing this exam. So their character is above suspicion. So when I went out and I came back inside, I saw two devotees sitting next to each other and discussing with each other and writing exam and writing the answers. So I said, what is going on? This is an exam, right? And they said, well, dadati pratigrihnati, guhyam akhyati prichyati. So I said, but what are you doing? He said, see, ultimately the principle is smaranam, to remember. And therefore we could not remember certain things. I am asking him, he couldn't remember certain things, he's asking me. So we are just having exchange of love, reciprocation. Exam is secondary. So I said, but you want to pass or not? That is the main anxiety why we are doing this. So when you have anxiety, then you struggle. And therefore, Krishna gives liberation even to those who were absolutely not at all inclined to be towards him. So what to speak of those who are in anxiety to approach his lotus feet? So one time Balaramji, he started thinking that Krishna is playing upon the flute. I should also play upon the flute. Why can't I play the flute? What is so special about the flute? So Balaramji decided, today I will go out and play the flute. So Balaramji went out with the flute and he started practicing. So that was the day Kamsa told Keshi that you please go and attack Vrindavan and you must kill Krishna and come back. All other efforts have failed. You are the last hope. So Keshi asked Kamsa, how do I identify Krishna? Kamsa said, very simple. He is the only person with the flute. As soon as you see him with the flute, attack him. So Keshi came running, entering into Vrindavan, and the first person he saw was Balaramji standing there practicing the flute. And Keshi thought, this is Krishna, and without even giving a warning, gave a huge kick to Balaramji. And then Balaramji was totally bewildered. And then he went to Krishna and said, your flute is very dangerous. Keep it with you. People are always hunting, trying to find out where you are and attacking you. So Krishna was constantly under attack in Sri Vrindavan. But it is described that although Krishna was attacked, Padbhyam Bhakta Hridistabhyam Bandabhyam Loka Vanditaihi Angam Yasyaha Samakramya Bhagavan Apitatstanam Yatu Dhani Apisaswargam Avapa Jananim Gatim Krishna Bhukta Stanakshira Kim Uggavo Numatara. That Krishna delivered Putana and gave her the position of mother in the spiritual world. And that was Krishna's special mercy upon Putana. And he delivered Putana, Shakatasur, Trinabarta, Nalukuvar, Manigriv, Vatsasur, Bakasur, Aghasur. All of these Krishna delivered because Krishna is always very favorably inclined towards his devotees. So therefore, nantar bahir yasya na chaparam purva pahir bahischantar jagatoyo jagatchayat. Krishna simply sees the love and affection of his devotees, and he sees that others who are inimical towards me, are they having a drop of some kind of a desire for a relationship with me? However negative that attitude may be, as soon as Krishna sees slight tinge of a relationship, Krishna agrees to deliver that person. And therefore, aho bhagyam, nanda gopa prajokasam, yanamitram paramanandam, purna brahma sanatanam. Brahmaji is glorifying Krishna that he is constantly reciprocating with the Brajavasis, because he sees the Brajavasis are eager to serve and please him, and Krishna delivers each and every demon who comes to attack him in Sri Vrindavan Dham. And so that is exactly what Brahmaji gets bewildered by when he sees tad adbhuta stotra swadya geetika, that after the killing of Aghasur, there is a big celebration. And Brahmaji is thinking, Aghasur is such a powerful demon, and this boy delivered this Aghasur and gave him liberation. Who's this boy? And that bewildered Brahmaji's mind. And that's how the Brahma Vimohan Leela actually began. And therefore, this second principle of how Lord is so much eager to deliver his devotees, to deliver the demons, to deliver those who are inimical towards him, this kind of daya and kripa is what makes Krishna's mercy super excellent. This kind of kripa has not been seen before, experienced before ever in the entire gamut of Krishna's pastimes. Like that. And so, Srila Prabhupada, in his beautiful purports, give this principle that Krishna is the incarnation of mercy. From top to bottom, if you just touch him, only mercy comes out. And therefore, kripa is the essence of Krishna's personality. So matu svinnagatraya visrishta kabrasraja drishtva parishramam Krishna kripayasit swabandhane. Krishna agrees to be bound by Mother Yashoda based on the kripa. Because when Yashoda Ma is performing so much of austerity effort, Krishna says, let me agree to be bound by her love. Because Kripa Maharani comes forward and says, all other logic and reason of all the other 15 energies of Krishna are overruled by Krishna's Kripa Shakti. And that is the power of Krishna's Kripa Shakti. It goes beyond logic, it goes beyond reason, it goes beyond qualification and disqualification. Krishna is simply there to deliver. In Russia, one young boy had set up a book table, Brahmachari, and he was trying to sell books. And this was right outside a conference of doctors. And so there were several doctors who were attending this conference. In lunchtime, one doctor came out and he saw the book table. And he saw this devotee, young Russian Brahmachari, and he got inspired to see this, and he said, who are you? And for whom are these books? And this young Brahmachari said, these books are for you. These books are not for anyone. These books are only for you. And this you know, doctor was little bewildered by seeing the self-confidence of this brahmachari. Because as you know, by studying Prabhupada's books and practicing Krishna consciousness, one thing we get in profuse quantity is confidence to answer any kind of question and face any challenging situation. Nowhere else I have seen this, that you say any questions, ask any question. So this doctor said, who are you and what exactly you're doing here? He said, well, I am not the body, I am the spirit soul, part and parcel of Krishna. I have come here to describe about Krishna to you. So this doctor said, oh my God, this is another type of answer. And then he said, what is your age? So this devotee said, whose age, body or the soul? So the doctor said, well, both. So he said, the body is only 23 years old, the soul is eternal. The doctor thought, this is too much. So he decided to purchase the book, read the book, became devotee, and is now initiated. And he said, what inspired me was the clarity and the confidence with which this devotee was answering the queries. And this is what transcendental knowledge does. It creates transformation of the heart. It energizes the intelligence with the confidence that yes, Krishna is there. If he can take care of even demon and deliver the demons, will he not take care of his devotees? And therefore, Krishna's kripa is all encompassing. The third is described here. Yayur ajita para shrir yad artha anya yatna. The third aspect of Krishna is after yasha, kripa. The third is Krishna's prema or intimacy, sweetness, madhurya. So the madhurya and prema of Krishna is such that even Lakshmi is looking forward to serve Krishna in this form. Even Vaikuntha does not avail that facility for Lakshmi. And so, yan martya lilopaikum swayoga mayabalam darshayita grihita vismapanam swasacha saubhagarde param padam bhushana bhushanangam. Uddhavji writes this beautiful verse where he says that amongst all the forms of Krishna, the sweetness of Krishna as Supreme Personality of Godhead is so enchanting and so bewitching that all the other incarnations of Krishna are also attracted to serve and reciprocate with that form of Krishna. That is the level of Krishna's sweetness. Vismapanam swasya cha saubhagarde. Krishna's opulences attract Krishna himself. Param padam bhushana bhushanangam. That is the supreme abode of all sweetness. And therefore, when Krishna appears to destroy Kaliya's pride and Krishna is dancing on the Kaliya. So Krishna has already jumped on Kaliya's head. But Krishna is not beginning the dance. And all the Brajavasis have come and the Brajavasis are feeling very much anxiety. What will happen to Krishna? Will Krishna survive this? Krishna will die. Kaliya will destroy Krishna with his wish, with his poison. But Krishna is very coolly standing there with his flute in his hand. His 1 foot on Kaliya, 1 foot raised up. Just like in a pose for dancing when you are about to begin, but not yet started. And all the Brajavasis are bewildered. Why Krishna is not starting? Because Krishna is waiting. For whom? The heroine. Radharani has not yet come. And so Krishna is waiting, wondering, how will the hero start the dance till the heroine comes? Because I have to impress her with this dance. So all the Brajavasis are looking at Krishna, thinking that whether Krishna will survive or not, but Krishna's mind is in another direction, that this is the golden opportunity for me to impress all the gopis and Radharani. Let me wait few more moments. This fool is anyway there. He is not going to go anywhere. But I am looking forward to attract the hearts and the minds of the gopis and especially Srimati Radharani. And when the gopis and Srimati Radharani came, then Krishna decided, okay, let me show a lesson, teach a lesson to this fellow. And then he began dancing. So therefore, everybody is looking at Krishna's demonstration of power, but Krishna himself is simply distributing the nectar of his sweetness. So that is Krishna's madhurya. And so, in the beautiful pastime of Krishna subduing Kaliya, so the Nagapatnis approach Krishna and then they are offering their prayers to Krishna and say, Kasyanu bhavu asyana deva vidmahe tavangri renu sparashadhikara yad vanchaya shri lana tapacharattapol vihaya kaman suchiram dridavrata. My dear Lord, we are unable to understand your mystical reciprocation. Kasya anubhavo asyana deva vidmahe. Are biggest rishis are performing austerity, still they are not able to get your darshan. What kind of austerity did our husband perform? He is envy personified. He simply spreads poison and he got the nectar of your lotus feet. How is it possible? Tavangri renus parashadhikara. From where he got the power to get the dust of your lotus feet? So the Nagapatnis are offering these prayers and Krishna is thus demonstrating his sweetness to his devotees like the Nagapatnis, and to Kaliya's pride, he's subduing that pride by stepping on his head again and again and brings out all the poison. So at one time Krishna brings out the poison of Kaliya's pride and Krishna enchants and drowns all of his devotees, especially the Nagapatnis and the Brajavasis, with the sweetness of his love. I was sharing this pastime the other day with the counselors that in Bhadrachalam there was this lady in a forest. She found a beautiful deity of Ram and Lakshman abandoned in that forest. She brought these deities of Ram and Lakshman and installed them and started worshipping. And then she was thinking that I do not have the right means to worship these deities. So she approached the local governor, who was a tax collector, and told the tax collector that actually you are more qualified to worship because you have the means, and I have a desire that if a beautiful temple can be made, it will be so nice. So the tax collector, his name was Ramdas, he loved these deities, he installed these deities and built a beautiful temple. But from where did he get the money for building the temple? He was supposed to give some money as tax to the local king. Instead of giving that money as tax to the king, he used that money to build this temple. And he thought, Ram is transcendental, and so this transcendental pastime will be understood by the king. When the king found out that the money which I was supposed to receive has been utilized for building the temple, he became angry. So he issued arrest warrant towards Ramdas and put Ramdas in jail. So when Ramdas is in jail, he started chastising Lord Ram. And he started saying, my dear Lord, where did you think this stone for the temple came from? Dasharath gave or what? I was the one who purchased all of the stone. And the beautiful jewelry and ornaments which you are wearing on your deities, do you think you got that as dowry? I purchased it, I brought it. And like this, he was chastising the Lord like anything in his bhav. That night, the king got a dream. And in the dream, Ram and Lakshman appeared. And Ram and Lakshman with folded hands started telling the king, Arey, please forgive Ramdas. For our sake, he built the temple. He has no other desire. He has simply pure desire to serve. You are only interested in that money. Take this money, whatever was spent for the temple, whatever was supposed to come in the form of tax, and more is there. Please release Ramdas. The king woke up with a start and he found a whole bag filled with gold coins and the money was much more than what he owed. The king came running to Ramdas
And he fell at his feet and started crying, "I made a mistake, I made a mistake, please forgive me." Ramdas said, "What happened?" He said, "In my dream, Ram and Lakshman came, they started chastising me, they started begging me, and they gave all of that money which was due to you. Please forgive me, I did not know to protect you, to serve you." Ram and Lakshman are personally involved. When Ramdas heard this, he started chastising Ram and Lakshman again. "My dear Lord, I am the one doing bhakti to you. I am building the temple for you. You are appearing in his dream." What is going on? The way you perform pastimes is inconceivable. So that's what the Nagapatnis are saying. Kasyanu bhavo asyana deva vidmahe tavangri renu sparashadhikara. We are the one performing devotional service. Our husband, who is envy personified, is getting the abhishek of the dust of your lotus feet. So therefore, Krishna's sweetness is unparalleled. And this sweetness has been demonstrated in his pastimes like in no other pastime. Then the fourth aspect of Krishna's personality, apart from his yasha, kripa, and madhurya, is his nama. Yan nama amangalagnam shrutam atha gaditam, in the form of giving his name as Krishna. Krish plus na indicates destruction of inauspiciousness and illusion. Chakravarti Path says, when recited, when Krishna nama is recited, it creates shruta matha. Shruta matha, that name totally crushes mathnati, excellence of all other spiritual practices described in the Shruti. And therefore, only Harinam is then established as the highest principle. And therefore, Yani Yani Hagitani Tadbala Charitani Tadadi Nirmantane Kale Smaranti Tani Agayata. And so, in the Bhajana Rahasya Shila, Bhaktivinoda Thakur explains that manah samharanam shaucham maunam mantrartha hetavah avyaya gratvam anirvedo japa sampatti hetavah. There are six ways in which one should come to the stage of offenseless chanting. So right now we are in the stage of offensive chanting. How do you go from offensive chanting to offenseless chanting? Bhaktivinoda Thakur says we have to follow these six things. What are the six things? First, manaha samharanam. First, try to control the mind. Make diligent effort to control the mind. Manaha samharanam. Second, shaucham, a lifestyle which is pure. Shaucham, the senses should be kept pure. Third, words, maunam. One should use words very, very carefully. Any criticism goes against the principle of offenseless chanting. Okay, mantrartha. Fourth is avyaya gratvam. Avyaya gratvam means you have to be steady in the practice. Not that one day you chant, next day you don't chant. Avyaya gratvam means avyagra. Vyagra means vichilit. Avyagra means steady. Fifth, anirvedo. Anirvedo means that not be discouraged. That today I did not chant well, oh, forget chanting then tomorrow. Do not become discouraged. Anirvedo. And then sixth is mantrartha chintanam. Namartha chintanam means smaran. Remember the mantra devata and engage in nyasa, prapatti, which is shelter, and sharanagati or surrender. Therefore, remember the whole meaning of the mantra. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And in this way, we perform the sankalpa. And this sankalpa is how I can engage in Krishna's service. continuously. And Chakravarti Path says, just like when you eat the pan is green in color. There are various things inside. But when you chew on the pan, then the lips turn what color? Yeah, we are not promoting that. But this is an example given by Chakravarti Path in his commentary, where pan is green, other ingredients inside are of different colors, but when you chew all of it together, what comes out? Red color. So like that, in bhakti there are different elements, but when you put all of these together, then what comes out through samharanam, shaucham, maunam, avyagratva, anirveda, mantrartha, chintanam, if all of these are put together, what comes out is offenseless chanting. And therefore, this is very important. So, independence leads to desire, distraction, deviation and distress. And therefore, we should not indulge in independent activities centered around sense gratification. So, this is this principle. So, holy name of Krishna destroys inauspiciousness, eradicates ignorance of his supreme position, and it overturns its excellence, all other attractions, attractive results of other sadhanas. So holy name brings all of these and much more. And then the fifth principle is described, yat krato gotra dharma, that the fifth principle is, he established dharma like no one else and no other incarnation. The supreme most establishment of dharma is there in this form. Yat krito gotra dharma. So gotra means that which delivers earth. Gotra means by the Lord, the sacrifice dharma of the mountain gotra, Govardhan puja was performed. Gotra means in worship of Govardhan, he made everyone understand their dharma with respect to his own form, gotra. Gotra refers to Krishna's form. Gotra means by Krishna was produced various types, gotra, of prema. Vatsalya, Madhurya, Sakhya. So it refers to various types. Gotra means by Krishna was produced natural, incomparable prema, dharma, in the gotras, the cowherd boys, the cowherd community. Gotra means by him was revealed highest form of having qualities of gotra or loving relationships. So in this way, Krishna, through his beautiful pastimes, has demonstrated and established all of these five principles, that his yasha, fame, his kripa, compassion, his sweetness, madhurya, his nama, holy name, and the establishment of dharma, which he demonstrated, excels any other incarnation as described here in 10th canto, 90th chapter, 47th verse, which you can then study at your leisure for getting a deeper understanding of this subject matter. And then the 48th verse gives the entire summary of Krishna Lila, all pastimes of Vrindavan, Mathura and Dwarka in one verse. So that is the 10, 90, 48. So these two verses are very important verses of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And as we are preparing our consciousness for Janmashtami, these verses are worth meditating and reflecting upon in the journey of purification of our mind, heart and consciousness, as this is the particular section which deals with purification of the self. Thank you all very much. Hare Krishna.